The story of Job is one of the most terrifying in all of Scripture to me. The reason it's terrifying is it tells the story of an executive meeting that took place in heaven. In that meeting, the angels of God gathered, and with them came Satan. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" And he answered, "Roaming to and fro over the face of the earth." And then God asks him this question. "Have you considered my servant Job? There's no one like him on earth. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." So now Job is being spoken about in an executive session of heaven, and he's going about his normal day's business. He's a farmer. He raises livestock. He's agrarian. Everything he does is done to serve the Lord God of heaven. When his children have a party, immediately afterward he offers a sacrifice to make sure that his children are covered, that they have not committed any sin that has not been repented of, or the blood has not been offered, an animal's life has not been offered in expiation of it. He doesn't know he's being talked about. Well, I don't know about you, but I like my privacy. I don't like people talking about me behind my back, making executive decisions about my life. I still like the illusion that I have some control over what's going to happen, what my destiny will be. And indeed, I do have some decision about that. But did you know that the Lord God of heaven is looking at your life right now? He's examining your behavior. He's examining the motives, the innermost movings of your spirit. He is looking at. He is carefully evaluating. And your name could very well have come up in the courts of heaven today. An executive decision may have been made regarding your life. Satan demanded Job for trial, and God has said yes. So we find in the book of Job, "Then the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job?' And then Satan replies in verse 9, this is Job, the first chapter, verse 9, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house? And everything he has, you've blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Very well, then everything he has is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." So an executive decision is made regarding Job's life in the heavenly realms. You understand today that there is a battle, a galactic battle between good and evil. And in that battle, you are being used. You are being watched. And all of heaven wants to know, will you serve the Lord God Almighty, or are you committed to serving the darkness? Are you worshiping yourself, or are you worshiping the Almighty? Now, Job was a religious man. He was given over utterly to the Lord. Many of you today are also religious who are listening to this broadcast. You go through the rituals. You perhaps attend church. You might even pay tithe. You might even be one who's preaching on Sunday. God is making decisions about your life. What will you do when that decision begins to touch your stuff? What will you do when God begins to let Satan take your children or your wife? Will you curse God then? It wasn't finished. Satan came back into that executive council of heaven another time. Job has now lost everything. He has gone before the Lord. He said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gives and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be blessed. Job did not sin by accusing God of any wrongdoing. So Satan comes again to that executive council of heaven. And the Lord again says to him, have you considered my servant Job? There's no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. And he still maintains his integrity, though you have incited me against him to ruin him without any reason. And Satan replies, skin for skin. A man will give all he has for his own life. But now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, very well then, he's in your hands, but spare his life. And so Satan goes out. He afflicts Job with painful sores from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. And now we see Job sitting in the ashes, mourning before God, stinks with the stench of sickness, with pus. He's scraping himself with a piece of broken pottery. And his wife is saying to him, are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die. And he says, you're talking like a foolish woman. Should we accept good from God and not trouble? And in all of this, Job still did not sin against the Most High God. He's being tested in the two most powerful tests a human being can suffer under. One is when God takes away from us what is precious. When he takes our job, when he takes our house, when he takes our stuff. And two, when he takes our children. And he allows Satan to do this. He allows Satan to come in and strip us out. And then if on top of that we lose our health, all we have left, literally, is our integrity, our character. Everything else has been taken. I've known people who have gotten sick. And when they've gotten sick, they've given up. They've lost hope. They've been angry with God. They've turned against him because if God's going to treat me this way, it's unfair. I know people who have lost a parent or a child or a husband or a wife, and they've grown bitter and angry in their heart. How could God do this? Somebody said to me yesterday, I'm angry at God. Well, why are you angry at God? Because he's let me be in this terrible situation. I said, well, why don't you choose to forgive God? But you know what? God didn't do anything wrong to you. It's simply the devil stripping out everything he can, and God is allowing that in order to test your heart, to reveal the person you are. So who are you today? Let me read from your psalm, the 11th psalm. I'll begin with verse 4. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. He observes everyone on earth. His eyes examine them. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked, those who love violence, he hates with passion. Do you see it? The Lord is looking at you. He is examining you. He understands who you are. And he knows if you love violence. And if you love violence, the Lord says God hates you because he hates violence. I know some of you who are listening to this broadcast call yourselves Christians, but you love the violent action movies. You love the violent sports. You love to see somebody mix it up. You love the martial arts, or you love some boxing, or you love some and other violent sports. You like to see men tangle. Saying the Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked, those who love violence, he hates with a passion. An executive decision may be made regarding your life in heaven today. It will be made at some point. God will make a decision about you at some point. He perhaps could make that decision today. The 11th chapter starts out this way, "In the Lord I take refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bows, they set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? The foundations of America are being destroyed today, and there are some who say, we ought to escape, we ought to run. But where can you run today? Where can you escape the high-tech surveillance? Where can you escape the wickedness of this culture? Wherever you go in America today, you're going to have the television spewing out its wickedness and its violence. You're going to have the telephone. You can't escape it. And the problem is, the foundations of our culture, the Judeo-Christian culture, are being utterly ripped apart. At the highest echelons of the government, there is now criminal activity. Lying, cheating, stealing. Where has all of this TARP money gone? Where's all of this Q1 and 2 and now 3? Where's all that money going? And where does the money come from in the first place? Well, did you know that money is printed by the Federal Reserve? And the Federal Reserve is not a government agency. It is an independent bank. Who owns the Federal Reserve? We don't even know that. It's kept secret. So they create the money, they loan it to the federal government, which means that every dollar that comes out to increase our money supply is done by debt. In fact, did you know that the dollar bill is in fact an instrument of credit? That's right. The dollar bill itself is an instrument of credit, and today in our culture, credit has become the real money. The dollar, gold, silver, that's no longer money. A store of value is no longer the money of our culture. Rather, credit has become our money. And the Federal Reserve note is merely an instrument of credit. The foundations are being destroyed. And so the fiat currency will collapse as people lose confidence in the ability of the dollar to produce what we desire to produce as an instrument of credit. And I checked just before coming to see what was happening with the dollar today. It is continuing to drop in value. Let me give you just a very small example. When I came out of the seminary about 42 years ago, I bought a beautiful brand new Mercedes-Benz, and I paid $4,000 for it. Today, do you know what it would cost to buy that same Mercedes-Benz? It's scary to even talk about it. You're looking at $80,000. Well, has the Mercedes-Benz become more expensive? Not really. The dollar simply dropped in value. My dad used to work for $30 a month. When he was blessed, he'd make $35 or $40 a month. That same money today would have to be $50,000 a month. What's happened? The value of the dollar has been completely eroded away, and it's continuing to drop in value. The day will come when a $100 bill will only be worth what $1 is worth. In fact, they'll do away with $1 bills, and everyone will be using $100 bills as a $1 bill. It's called hyperinflation. How do I know that's going to happen? I'm not a prophet, nor the son of a prophet. Simply look at the history of money. In every instance, across the board, whether we're talking about Argentina or we're talking about the Weimar Republic, in every instance, when the money supply has been widened, increased, with nothing of value behind those dollars or that currency has totally collapsed. It has lost its value. That's why many people today are saying, take your dollars that you have left and put them into something that will retain its value, because the dollar used to be a store of value. You could take your dollar and trade it in for silver or for gold. You can't do that today. There's no standard of value behind a $1 bill. It's imaginary. It's simply a credit instrument. And as people lose confidence in that, many economists today are encouraging Americans to put their money into gold or silver, put their money into property, put their money into something that will retain a portion of the value more so than the dollar bill. The scriptures are saying, when the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? Well, certainly, we can be wise. We can take our dollars and invest them now in the kingdom of God, because that's for eternity. We can take our dollars and invest them in gold and silver, physical gold and silver. We can invest in property. We can invest in the lives of young people. There are many, many different things we can do with our dollar while it still has some value. We can put away a year's worth of food in the closet. Because what will you do when the dollar collapses and the grocery stores are stripped bare? Where will you go to get food? Joseph knew a famine was coming, and that's why he stored away in the surplus years, so that when the famine came, he would have food available for the Egyptians. Do you have food available? What an incredible investment to invest in toilet paper and paper towels and food stuffs that will last. Because a year from now, they're going to cost a great deal more than they do now. Inflation will take a hold. So there are things that we can do. The foundations are being destroyed. What can the righteous do? Verse 4, the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. He observes everyone on the earth. His eyes examine them. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked and those who love violence he hates with a passion. And on the wicked he will rain fiery coals and burning sulfur. A scorching wind will be their lot. For the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. The upright will see his face. America is now beginning to experience the fiery coals, the burning sulfur, and the scorching wind. That will be the lot of America. Where will you be as these things begin to transpire in America? Have you repented of your sin? Are you clean before God? Or are you still looking forward to all of the wonderful American lifestyle that you think you're entitled to? My brother and my sister, Jesus is coming. The party is over. The foundations are being destroyed. And I want to share also with you Psalm 32. And by the way, my name is Ray Greenley. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. You're welcome to call. I'd love to speak with you. I'm here now live. The phone number is 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. You're also welcome to go to our webpage. We're streaming live right now at nationalprayerchapel.com. nationalprayerchapel.com. You'll find there the streaming live video, and you'll also find a podcast that will be available later in the day, and you're welcome to download that free of charge. And by the way, just to give you an idea of what's happening with the webpage, last month we had about 2,000 people download our podcast, look at our broadcast. And I want to thank all of you who are coming to the webpage, and I pray that you're encouraged by what you're finding there. I also want to tell you that at the end of this month, Pilgrim's Progress will no longer be broadcasting on WAVA AM. We are leaving the air, but we will continue broadcasting at the same time on our webpage, nationalprayerchapel.com. So, as we go into the month of November, you will not find us here, but you're most welcome to go to our webpage, and there you will find the broadcast continuing, and it will, of course, be free of charge to each of you. Our mailing address, let me give that to you. It's National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Again, that's National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. My heart cry is that we could transition from the AM side of the dial to the FM side of the dial. Would you join with me in praying that we could make that transition and that the Lord would open the way financially to make that transition? So we're waiting on the Lord, but we will definitely be going off Nova AM as of the end of this month. Again, our phone number here in studio, 877-534-0780. I also would still like to invite at least one more couple to join us and have dinner together with me on the 18th of this month at 6:30 in the evening. If you'd like to join for that free dinner at the Bistro Le Hermitage, a wonderful five-star French country restaurant, we're going to have a meeting and we're going to spend that time talking about Jesus. It's not a fundraising. I don't do fundraising. It's going to be strictly to share together what the Lord Jesus has done in our hearts as we close off this broadcast, as we conclude doing this broadcast. So if you'd like to be included in that dinner, please call right now and talk with Eric. Give him your name and your phone number. You won't go on air. Just give him your name and your phone number and say, my wife and I would like to join you for that meal. Or I'm a single person and I would like to come and be a part of that time of fellowship. Again, it's on October 18 at 6:30 p.m. in Woodbridge, Virginia. And we'll give you all of the directions to the bistro off air. But I would love to meet with you and get acquainted with you. So call right now, 877-534-0780. Let's go now to Psalm 32. I've been meditating over this psalm and crying out to the Lord over it. And I was impressed by the Lord this morning in the early hours as I was before him on my face to share it with you. David writes, "Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered." You remember in the old covenant, sins were covered because they were under declared righteousness. Their sins were not wiped away because Jesus had not yet died on Calvary. And the blood of bulls and goats cannot erase sin. Only the blood of Jesus can erase sin. And so David uses the word appropriately, covered, instead of made righteous. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against him, and in whose spirit is no deceit. David is describing a man or a woman who is finally sold out. They are all in. In the new covenant, we would say a person who has been crucified with Christ, who no longer walks in any known sin, but walks righteous before the Lord. A person who has been justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. And of course, the word justified in Old English means literally to be made righteous. And dikaiosune, the Greek word that is used in the New Covenant, means literally in the Greek to be made righteous, to be made innocent. In other words, sin is removed from that person. And he's saying, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. Now David knows about this personally. He says, when I kept silent, my bones wasted away. And through my groaning, all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. So my concern today, as I speak with many Christians who keep silent about their sin, they don't know that their bones are wasting away. They don't know that their life is draining away. They do not feel the hand of God day and night heavy on them. Their strength is sapped, but they don't know it because they have believed a lie. They have comforted themselves with false teaching that they're saved in the midst of their sin. And so they can keep silent and their life is wasting away. There's a deadness in their spirit. There's a groaning in their heart, but they're not even aware of it because they've filled their life with religious rituals. They're religious men and women. They're not righteous men and women. Do you see the difference? You can be a Christian person, be a religious person, and think that everything is fine and not feel this conviction of God on your heart. And you go about your day's work and you're casual about everything and you're laughing and you're talking with people. You're going to the sporting events. You're watching your television. I know a man now who has a lymphoma cancer that is utterly consumed with the football games. Can you imagine a Christian man who's dying, but he believes he's okay with Jesus, and he spends his time watching the football games, going here and there, enjoying his life as his life drains away, and yet there's despair in his heart, there's tear in his spirit, he has no peace in God. But he knows he's saved. And so he's welcome to go and do whatever he wants to do. He's welcome to spend his money any way he wants to spend it. He's making plans now for his death. He has no real hunger for God. He's fine. He goes to the wonderful Baptist church where he's told that he's saved, that the grace of Jesus covers him, but there's no peace in his heart. But he doesn't feel the conviction of sin, because if he did, he would repent, and the peace of God would enter his heart, and then he could begin to talk with the Lord about healing him or not healing him, and he would be drawn into the heart of Jesus. But instead, he has religion. He has the rituals of the church. He has the wonderful preacher who is too busy to talk to him. He has everything he desires, except the peace of Jesus is not in his heart. I pray some of you are identifying as I'm speaking to you about this. In verse 5, David says, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity." Well, what if your iniquity and your sin has been covered up by your religion? What hope is there for you? If there is no conviction of sin, what hope is there for you? Countless numbers of people are being swept into hell who call themselves Christians, who long ago, if they were ever on the narrow path, have long ago cast aside all of the bonds. They cast aside all of the abiding places in Jesus. They now are just jolly, well-met people, convenient to talk with, talk about the sporting activities, talk about the television, talk about the movies, talk about everything that's going on in the culture, talk about politics, but no conviction of sin. No heaviness of heart regarding their own condition before God. It's not just this man who's dying of cancer. You understand, we're all in the process of dying. The question is, when will we die? Some will die by accident. Some will die by disease. Some will die of old age. But it's 100% mortality rate. We're all going to die. Content to live my life walking in the way of the world without recognizing when sin comes into my life and my bones begin to waste away and a heaviness creeps into my spirit. I'm not willing to walk like that. I want Jesus with all my heart. And I pray constantly, Lord, if there's any sin found in me, would you convict me of that? And I tell you, there was a time when I walked in all of the wilderness as a pastor. I walked in all of the professional sports, loving them, knowing all about them. I knew about all of the movies that were coming out and the television shows. someone said to me, Pastor, what about your sin? And I said to them, what do you mean? I repented. I don't know of any sin. Oh, there's some things I'm working on. I know I'm not perfect. And nobody is. And so we have things we have to work on. Boy, did the Lord come crashing into my life. I fell under such heavy conviction, I lay on my face before God and wept. But to do that, he had to take away all of my money. He had to take away my two houses. He had to take away my two cars. He had to take my savings. He had to take everything away from me. And finally, when I crashed and I hit rock bottom, I then was willing to lay on my face before him and repent of my sin. Admit how arrogant I had been. Now, please, I pray this doesn't need to happen in your life. I pray that you can hear my word and respond and do it the easy way. I have to admit, I'm pretty hard-headed, and I usually do things the hard way. And I'm trying to encourage you today not to do it the hard way. I'm trying to encourage you to do it the easy way. And the easy way is to begin to cry out to God. And if you don't know what your sin is, ask the Lord to show you what your sin is. And as he shows you the lust of your heart, as he shows you the pride of your life, as he shows you the bitterness and unforgiveness that is tucked away in the corners of your soul, as he shows you where you need to make restitution, I pray that you will acknowledge your sin and not try to cover up your iniquity. But instead, I pray that you will, like David, confess your transgressions to the Lord, and he will forgive you. He will forgive you of the guilt of your sin. He will wash away your iniquity. He will make you clean before heaven. Verse 6 of Psalm 32 says, therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. The mighty waters are rising in America. The foundations are being destroyed. The floods, the tornadoes, they're rising. The hail, natural disasters. We're going to see devastation as earthquakes come upon America. The West Coast is going to be utterly destroyed. Down through the middle of our country, we have nuclear reactors, the same as Fukushima's nuclear reactor, all along the fault line, running down through Arkansas, running right down through the center of our nation, the New Madrid Fault. Such utter devastation is about to come on our nation. Our fiat currency is ready to collapse. Our debt is so huge we can't begin to pay it off. He says, surely there's the rising of the mighty waters. But he says that those who confess their sin, who are faithful before God, the mighty waters will not reach them. He says, verse 7, you are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Are you hidden in that place today? Or are you continuing walking in your sin, unconscious, untroubled? Your life is wasting away, but you're a happy camper, fat and happy, looking for a pastor who will give you a pat on the head and say, there, there, you're okay, you're saved. Is that what you're doing? Or are you walking with a humble heart, repenting of your sin, convicted by the Holy Spirit at the slightest move out of the narrow path. That's why this broadcast is called Pilgrim's Progress. We're on the way to the celestial city. We have left behind us the city of destruction. That's what he's saying. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Oh, my brother, my sister, if you are singing songs of deliverance today, if you are making positive affirmations about your place in Jesus, but you have not repented of your sin, you have deceived yourself. And what can the Lord do to save you then? If there is arrogance in your spirit and you're putting yourself forward as somebody, I can't tell you how it saddens my heart when a man or woman comes and they've come to the National Prayer Chapel and they've said, I'm an apostle. Really? You're an apostle. You perform the same miracles that the apostles performed. You heal the sick, you raise the dead, you preach the gospel, you start churches. You're an apostle. Well, no, my pastor told me I was an apostle. Really? Or others will say, I'm a minister. I'm somebody. I'm the righteousness of God. I'm a priest. I'm an intercessor. Really? Where did you get all of those inflated names? When people come telling me these kinds of things, they don't understand that an intercessor, an apostle, a pastor, a minister, these are functions. These are not positions that grant us an elevated position among God's people. These are servant positions or servant functions, not positions. So when someone comes and they begin to make all kinds of bold claims, and then I see the uncleanness of their life, I'm grieved. I'm grieved. Some of you are called armor bearers, but you don't know how to wield the sword of the Spirit. Well, whose armor are you bearing? Is it the armor of darkness, of pride, of arrogance, of hardness of heart? Or is it humility, love, compassion, humbleness of spirit? Some of you call your pastor's wife the first lady of the church. Really? She's the first lady. That's her position. See, that's not the Lord. The pastor is not the CEO. He's not the head of the church. Jesus is to be the head of the church. And the pastor is to be the under-shepherd, and he is to be the servant of all. He is to be the humblest. He is not to set himself up as somebody, and not to set his wife up as somebody. The pastor's wife should be the humblest of all of God's people. That humility should be evidenced in caring for the saints, not in dressing in fine clothes and posing as somebody who is something. I will never forget, I got an invitation from my wife to come to a church here in Washington for the first ladies to be treated. And they were going to look at fur coats, and credit was available, and they would be encouraged to come and buy their wonderful mink. Really? See, this is not God. This is not the humility of heart that he's called for. See, there's a refusal to acknowledge our sin. There's a refusal to humble our heart before God Instead, we want to reach up and take a position and be somebody. See, David says, therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising waters of the mighty water will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect them from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. And I will instruct you, he says. This is Jesus speaking now. I will instruct you, David, and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. He said, please, my people, don't be like donkeys. Don't be like mules. Don't be like horses. Don't make me put a bit in your mouth. See, the one truth that abounds over all others in the scripture is the love and mercy and compassion of our Lord. He wants to save our souls. And he's willing to do whatever is necessary to get our attention. He was willing to allow Satan to take Job's possessions and family. He was willing to let Job lose his health, all so God could make a full revelation of himself, that the pride of Job's heart could be broken. God loves us enough to do what is necessary to break our pride. And fundamentally, isn't that what we're talking about? Isn't that what prevents us from knowing our sin and walking in cleanness before God? David concludes this wonderful psalm with, many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad. Be glad, you righteous. Be glad, you who are made righteous. Not be glad, you who are pretend righteous. He says, sing, all you who are upright in heart. He does not say, sing, all of you who are religious. See why I hate religion? My Christian faith I do not consider as religion. I don't buy the rituals of the church calendar. I want Jesus in all of his fullness, in all of his majesty. And when I sin against him, I want the heaviness of spirit to fall upon me, that I could quickly be convicted and repent and turn, that the Lord would heal me of that and purify me from all unrighteousness. The normal life of the Christian faith is a life of joy and peace. It is a life of service. It is a life of humility. The normal life of the Christian is one of joy. It is one of celebration. It is one of trust in Almighty God. Is that your walk today? We have a few minutes left. I haven't heard from any of you today. Our phone number is 877-534-0780. If you'd like to share your testimony of victory and the joy of serving Jesus, you're welcome to call. Or if you need to call and be prayed that the convicting power of the Holy Spirit would fall upon you, and call right now, 877-534-0780. I'm Ray Greenley, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. We will be leaving the air here on WAVA AM at the end of this month, the month of October. We will be able to continue to reach us if you have the internet. We will be streaming live at the same time every day, Monday through Friday, at nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com. You're welcome to contact us. You'll find that information at nationalprayerchapel.com, or you can write to me at the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. My heart's cry is that we can transition to the FM side of the dial. Would you join us and pray that we can make that transition? We have no money to make that transition, but it's not a money problem. Is this what the Lord wants, and will He open the way for us? So again, I want to give you our mailing address, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. You're also welcome to join with us at 6:30 for prayer on Tuesday evenings, and then at 7:30 we begin with praise and worship. We meet at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. That's located on Gideon Drive, right beside the Hilton Memorial Event Center, or the Hilton Memorial Chapel. You're also welcome to join us on Sundays. We meet at 12:30 p.m. at the All Saints Anglican Church, 12:30, and you're welcome to join us. In the time we have left, let me pray with you. Almighty God, you've put such a heavy burden on my heart for the men and women in the city of Washington, D.C., and I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will come with convicting power. Lord, I know many today will be thinking about what has been said, and they'll be going back and reviewing the psalm in Psalm 32. I pray, Lord, that as they do this, your convicting power will fall upon them. Lord, I know revival comes when there's conviction of sin. I know it does not come by my preaching. When we're teaching, it comes by your Spirit. So, Lord, I plead today, will you send your Holy Spirit? You were concerned about Nineveh. Surely, Lord, you're concerned about Washington, D.C. Would you come with power? And would you touch the life of every person now listening? I pray in your holy name. Amen. God bless you. I'll talk with you soon.
Before the presence of His glory, with great joy, with great joy. Now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory with great joy, with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord.